well, or other ideas.
So what's the pleasure of the board? What would you all like to do? Would you like to think about it? Would you like to have a motion to go ahead and have Tom do it? Would you like to forget it? What do you want to do? I'm open to whatever you guys want.
I think it'd be a benefit.
So do we need to do a motion for that? For you to go ahead?
A motion, or at least three people nod in my direction here. I got one. I'm assuming you brought it forward. You're interested.
Yeah.
All right. I don't hear anyone in opposition to it. I heard some concerns, but not that you don't want it to happen.
No, I'm
just
constructive discussion. We can always cancel it after this year, right? I mean, we don't have to renew it, so.
That's right.
That's right.
Okay. We'll move forward with that. We'll keep you updated.
I do not want this to take away from any potential training that the planning commissioners can be made available to
them. We're discussing that. What would be the pleasure of the board as far as the 2.5 day or the 1 day? I think I like the idea of 2.5 days, but I've got more time than most people, so 1 day is an option. And I think the sooner the better that we can get.
Well, Tom said they're keeping an eye out for it, so the next one that's available, they're going to let us know.
But you weren't keeping an eye out for the 1 day.
But he said they just got it.
And the 1 day one
has coming out very quickly.
Well, my question is, what do y'all like? Do y'all like the 1 day or the 2.5 day?
I did not get the details. My guess is no. I got a reminder, but it's coming out.
So my question is,
do you know how frequently they do that?
They kind of intermittently, when they get 10 people, you know, they'll offer it to the area. I've been to two of them, one down in South Georgia. But my question is, would the board rather go to a 1 day or to a 2.5 day?
It doesn't matter. It would depend on when it is.
I need a motion to recess the meeting for 5 minutes.
I just want to pull in some extra chairs.
Oh, okay.
Second. Motion to recess, and Commissioner Neal made a second. All those in favor of a 5-minute recess, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Me.
4-1, Commissioner Moses is opposed.
Thanks. Tighter. Thank you.
Cozy. I'm going to reach over you and grab my phone. Excuse me.
Said the law of torts. I thought you were.
It is about law. I'm talking about.
Yeah, no. So I can think of more exciting.
Yeah.
we got.
Additional agendas at the table.
So after the recess, I would like to call the meeting to order at 6:50.
We're going to pick up where we left off.
We're going to pick up where we left off, and I think you were in mid-sentence.
I was. I just wondered, you know, I asked my question. I guess that everybody would. Y'all run the 2.5 for one day, or would you want us all to go together at one time? Or do you want people to pick and choose where they want to go? I'm just trying to get an idea of what everybody's interested in. Because I'm just excited to see that we are interested in talking about it.
And it's going to be dependent on when it is. I mean, because it could be a good day, a good week for it to be a two-day session, or it could be a really awful week for it to be a two-day. You know, you just never know.
Mine's going to have to be a one-day.
I mean, so we're going to, it sounds like that maybe everybody's just on their own. Is that what y'all kind of want to do? Or?
Probably the easiest. Most likely that we would all get to go.
Mm-hmm. Are there any concerns about quorum issues, or does no. that, they change the law, or is it against
yeah,
that's not an issue?
The one thing I was concerned about, though, is as we were kind of all nodding and saying we're comfortable signing up for this web service. You mentioned that not if it came before someone gave them training.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if there's interest in that one-day class, and it's about the same price as this website,
mm-hmm.
$100.
Well, no, it's the one day is $95 a person.
Okay.
But
for
I
one
said,
person, it's about the same price.
But he said
yeah.
one of us could go.
So
well, the thing is,
I can't commit. Right now, my training budget is somewhat limited, and I got a lot of staff members that I had training years. I can't commit to that. I have $600 this year to spend on the Planning Commission. So,
how do y'all feel about
signing up for this website? Would keep one person away from going to that class if you took. I know off the top of my head, I can give you $100. $600 is a little harder to find, and I have to do some on. I just won't put that out there. Mm-hmm. Technically, if there's interest in that one-day class, it's the equivalent of this website for one attendee. I don't want to overcomplicate the same. I just want to make sure I'm giving you the answers that you ask as well.
My personal feeling is that if the county is going to pay for it, then we need to go when the county tells us to go.
Mm-hmm.
If we're going to pay for it ourselves, you know, like go where we want to go when it's convenient, then we ought to just go and pay for ourselves, which is what's been running for the past.
Yeah, well, Tom has indicated that but there's not budget money right now for the training.
That
so.
Doesn't mean we don't need it.
No.
So, I'm just trying to, I haven't gotten a sense of what people think about it. I mean, except, yeah, it's a good idea, but is that something that everybody wants to do within a couple of months, or?
Well, I don't think I don't think at this point in time people really know when they'll be able to do it. I do think I would encourage everyone to look into it to see when there are available classes, and do it when you can do it, when you have the money, when you have the time, because it's very beneficial to go through the training.
Well,
I went through the ARC,
yeah.
And you did the other, so between the two of us,
but,
we have two different versions of training.
Nobody else has gone. You know, if you just leave it up to, then it seems like you're not the ones that have been to the classes. And if you just leave it open, then nobody else goes. And that's a concern I have.
Well, to be fair, I mean, Alan and I haven't really had much time to go, so.
The cost hasn't been a factor in me deciding not to go.
Well, and see, that's what I'm trying to say. I mean, how important is it to you? You know,
well, I know that the ARC one is usually offered in February. It's only once a year normally when they have the one for the ARC, and it's one day in February and one day in March when I did it. Whether it's different now, I don't know. I've not looked. But when the University of Georgia does it, do they ever do like a group rate where they come to you? Is there anybody who does something like that?
They will come here.
We did that
with 10 people.
Maybe 2007, sometime around then. We did bring in a guy from out of state. He's from Virginia. And he gave us a group price to sit down with the Planning Commission and have a half day. It was even a full day session.
Well, yeah, this one. Christy Marlowe will do that. She'll come if you can get 10 people together, but you might end up having to pay her more if you only get four or five. But maybe we can work something out with Dawson County or another county nearby and get some people and maybe have it here. But at the same time, that may not be convenient for people too. So that's I don't accept the argument that it's not convenient. Because everybody seems to make these meetings.
Well, maybe we need to talk about this when we talk about the bylaws, because that might be an inclusion in the bylaws when we go to do them about training.
I've tried.
So, we'll forward you the, I hadn't forwarded on the one day one. I didn't realize, Jody, you had gone to that one.
Twice.
And you had positive stuff to say about it before that.
I've been to two one days.
About the ARC one.
Yeah.
It's like Vanessa said that the shot clock is ticking on that one, but we'll. Tomorrow we'll forward out that email to you if you can see it, and if a member is interested.
Is there anything offered from the Planning Association, the Georgia Planning Association? Do they do any Planning Commission training?
I think that's...
Anything like that?
At their conferences, sometimes I've seen sessions that cater to a Planning Commissioner, but I haven't that in a while. I don't expect it to be cheaper than the one day one through UGA and Jody's reference.
Yeah, and it's 95 a person, or was when Jody did it, is that correct?
Yeah, and we just saw that email. I want to say it's about that.
Now they hand out a booklet that's about this, to, you know, what they talk about there. So, I mean, you leave.
Well, I'm wondering if you coordinated it, but we all paid $95 a piece, would anybody object to that?
I might.
You might?
I have a tough time asking an appointed board to come out of pocket for training, and I think it's also difficult.
Are you saying you want to reimburse?
To acknowledge you may not be interested in paying. Even if it is $95, mm-hmm. not $900.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a little hesitant to jump on that. And I might say, as an alternative, I prefer we dedicate some staff time. We could talk upstairs. We could look at my budget a little closer. Maybe we can find enough money to cover half of it. Maybe we can go upstairs, ask if there's anyone from the BOC, any kind of funding that they might be able to make available to help us out. I'd like to look down a couple of those paths first before we take a roll call on who wants to come out of pocket for it.
Okay. That sounds like a good idea, and we can talk more about that when we get to number 7 or 8 on the agenda. 8.
And 8? Okay.
Yeah, because we can include that in it. So where did we leave this? We didn't have a vote, right?
I'm hearing right now that we're probably holding off on any action right now.
Yeah.
It might come up as number 8, and if it doesn't come up as number 8, Vanessa and I will just put it on a future work session agenda to talk about again.
Okay, and for the website, we're just scratching it for now.
We're just going to wait.
On hold for right now.
We'll try to incorporate that into the bylaws too at some point.
In the meantime, we can just take a look at the site and see what...
Yeah, you can take a look at the site. You can get some stuff, like Tom said, for free. Some of the articles, you can read part of the articles if you don't subscribe. So there is stuff that you can look at on there.
What is the site?
It's Planner's Web.
I'll send everybody an email on the one. I don't have the information on the LLC, but I'll be glad to send everybody a little information on the Carlton Institute over in Georgia and the class they have. It tells you about it and what the schedule and put the class in.
Okay.
So I'll just give you something to look at.
So next on the agenda is discussion on perfecting the minutes.
Yes, I had some email, at least one email about what's the proper way to identify and correct changes to the draft minutes. The question wasn't about once we adopt it, but it was about Vanessa sends out the draft or one of our staff members sends out the draft. Someone sees something that they think is a correction. What's the best way you want to handle it? And the most straightforward answer, and it's something that Joey pointed out, is in our bylaws, it talks about the different steps of our meeting and the rules of procedure for our meeting. And item four is adopt or amend the minutes from past meetings. So one very simple answer, and we can talk about it more though, is we always have the option of at the meeting when the minutes are being adopted to suggest any changes at that time. If you think something does not accurately reflect what happened in that prior meeting, you can bring it up then. I think this last, Vanessa may help me out, this last month we had a few different emails going back and forth on improvements, changes to the draft product. Is that right?
Correct. There were two suggested changes and also comments about what was intended versus what was said.
Mm-hmm.
So
this last month, it went around an email more, and then you replied an email that of which ones you would change and then
I reset a revised draft out via email for everyone to review. And did not receive any further comment after it was revised.
Does everybody read the bylaws?
Well,
because it's in the bylaws.
And where I'm going next with that is, yes, I think the bylaws identify that we have that opportunity at the meeting, and it's always going to be a part of our meeting that we have that opportunity to do it. But at the same time, I don't think the bylaws are prohibiting you from looking at them or sharing ideas ahead of time either. And does one particular way or not work for you procedurally?
Procedurally for staff, it would be easier to make a correction so what you adopt is before you in written form rather than.
I think there are ethical concerns.
So we're all clear about what's being seen before it's adopted. That would be my only reservation, is that through discussion, one person might have an understanding, but again, not seeing it in writing mm-hmm. before they make the motion to adopt. That would be.
So we have to be, if we're doing it at the meeting, we have to make sure we're very clear on.
Yes.
The whole discussion is something already happened at a meeting, and maybe we don't have it correct on paper.
Right.
So in trying to fix that, we have to make sure we're very clear, very precise, and get it the second time around.
Well, so if we discuss it a little bit beforehand, you have the opportunity to go back and look at the tapes to see what was
yes.
actually said versus what
that
we
came
remember,
up this last time,
you know?
I think.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But so, I'm not sure about the state ethics laws on that. We've gone down that road. With trying to change minutes and stuff.
But when it's in draft form,
Ken, Ken was here and gave us a talk not too long ago.
Right.
And he basically said there's not a whole lot of difference between the draft form. Do y'all remember this?
Yeah.
He basically said there's not a whole lot of difference between the draft form. He said there's a difference. But in his opinion, there's not a difference between the draft form and the real form. That's what he said.
Yes.
And we're paying him to tell us what to do. And he's saying, basically, don't fool until you have the minutes. That's what I recall.
That's what
from,
I
We needed to make sure everyone was absolutely clear what we were voting on. And if something changed to the draft, everyone had to be clear what changed, why it changed, and preferably have that written, edited document in front of them.
But I just recall him saying that he didn't say, I think there was a video that I'm just saying there are ethical considerations about the way we handle this stuff. And if you're not familiar with the state laws on the ethics, then we need to read them and become familiar with them.
Well, when we get to number 7, we can add that to the list.
Number 8. Okay. So right now, our staff answer is we can make either work. We need to make sure everyone's always very clear what we're doing. And if the Planning Commission wanted to go out of their way to adopt something where they were only going to do it a particular way, we could work with that as well.
Okay.
Man, I would prefer to put staff on notice, at least, even if they provided minutes in a markup form from the draft minutes so that we had exactly what had changed from the draft. But you know, just because there is the ability to go look at other resources and research those questions before we have a meeting, because otherwise at that meeting we have limited resources to try and address those.
But then at the same time, there's nothing that says you have to adopt the minutes right then. You can bring it up in public, talk about it at the meeting, and then wait another month to accept the minutes. So there's not a problem with doing it all out in the open.
I mean, if all the changes were brought up at the meeting, that would be in the open, as long as all the changes, any changes from the draft were brought up in the meeting.
Yeah, but not on emails and stuff. I'm not trying to criticize you. I'm trying to keep us from getting outside the bounds of what we're supposed to be doing.
Are we on to email communication,
and that's a good opening for it, I would say.
Slid right in there. Anyway.
Yeah.
I think Pam, you'd emailed me, asked about email communication among Planning Commission members, and in particular, sending an email from one Planning Commissioner to the entire Planning Commission.
Right.
And is that, if that happens, do we get into challenges with open meetings and state violations in general? And the answer is, well, it depends on the content of your email. If, say you've just got something from a citizen regarding a rezoning, and you feel like everyone, the Planning Commission should have it, and you just forward it on to everyone. Hey, I got this, I'm sharing it with everyone. That's not a problem, you can do that. If your communication, though, an email looks like getting into debate and deliberate, getting into the details, debating the cases that are going to be before you, that would be challenging. And I would advise you not to do that. And that's a pretty generic answer. I hope it's enough for you to go on. I'll try to answer questions for you if you have them. But if you really have a lot of detailed questions on there, we'd probably pull the legal staff back in to talk to you about it. But the general answer is, forwarding stuff on, sharing some factual type stuff is not a problem. Debate through email is a problem when you're sending it out to the entire Planning Commission. If it looks like we're conducting a meeting through email, we don't want to be doing that.
Didn't we make a, or Vanessa, I don't know if you remember because you might not have been here, but Tom, didn't we decide to have a section for announcements on our agenda, and did we vote to always, I was thinking we did, didn't we?
We voted no.
Oh, we voted no.
Either that or we didn't have a vote, but the consensus was that we weren't going to add announcements to the agenda. That was a couple of months ago, I think.
Yeah, I don't remember. thinking that we didn't. I know we talked about it, but I don't remember saying, maybe we didn't say much.
We did.
I'll double check.
Is that all about the email communication?
It's all. If I've answered your question, yes, that's all.
Defusion. Discussion on efficient public hearing procedures.
This is just one quick follow-up. Maybe you could say a plea from the staff. We had a month or two ago, we had Ken here talking about his training class. And one of the things he mentioned was, ideally, during the hearing, to hold your question, as a planning commissioner, if you could hold your questions until the public hearing is closed, that's ideal. It's not one of our rules. It's not something you have to do, but it's ideal. And I'm reminding of you of that and asking you to consider that as you move forward. We still have a lot of it. And it makes it difficult from a couple standpoints. One is our staff member from the engineering department has volunteered to run that clock to see if the meeting is the stopwatch. And when we get into that question and answer period, while the public hearing is still going on, he's consistently turning around to me, Tom, should I start the stop? Stop it? Should I pause it? And quite honestly, there's a lot of times I don't know, or I think, no, don't start it yet. But then where the discussion goes, then I'm whispering to him, start it back up. So it makes it challenging. And again, our goal being that we're providing a level playing field for both sides. Both sides got 10 minutes, or they may not use it, but they had 10 minutes available. You get into that question and answer during the public hearing, and it just gives people on the, people who didn't get the answer they liked, people who came out on the losing end of the decision, they look back at it and think, that guy, you know, he got to answer all these questions, and it was a yes-no question, but instead of saying yes-no, he talked for 3 minutes, and it was a sales pitch. It wasn't just answering a question. Because of all that stuff, just asking you to take it into consideration. It's not a violation of any rule we have. It just makes for a better meeting, in my opinion, and it makes it easier for staff as well. So that's all I have on that one.
So after we close the public hearing and we are discussing,
mm-hmm.
then we can call
someone back up
if we want to.
Or opposition, we call the applicant.
Okay.
Ask, the goal there is you're asking more focused questions.
Mm-hmm.
Not just asking them to come back up and talk more. Everyone knows we can extend the clock if we want, as long as we extend it evenly. And if you extend the clock, you can open it up. It's just open mic. People can talk what they want. If you're not doing that formal extension of the public hearing, try to keep it focused on very specific questions.
So if somebody's presenting their case and they ask us if we have any questions, are we saying that we don't want to ask them right then? Or the only thing is, sometimes you lose the train of thought.
I agree. And,
you know,
again, I'm telling you, this isn't a rule. It's a good meeting practice.
Sometimes you just can't do it.
Maybe we should try to write it down. I've done that and written the person's name down too if I knew that I was going to ask them something that I'd remember because so much goes on and so much time goes on and so many more people come up that sometimes it is hard to keep your train of thought and to remember.
Yeah. So. But if we do happen to ask somebody, you're going to stop us.
Yeah. Hopefully.
Even though it's not against the rules, you're going to stop us.
Yeah. You going to test me?
Okay. I wanted to bring up one other thing too about meeting. One thing that's a concern to me, and it's come up here lately, is we are a recommending body, which to me means that we give our opinion on something, and the idea behind that is for us to help the Board of Commissioners, you know, by looking into stuff and being kind of independent and seeing what's, you know, look into it ourselves. It seems like that we've been having the commissioners, and of course the Board of Commissioners can pretty much do what they want to, I guess, but when they come in and pull me or somebody else over to the side and start telling us how we're going to vote or telling us how we need to vote or telling us what we need to say, that's a disservice to them. And they may not even realize it themselves. But rather than, in other words, I think the commissioners ought to let us do what we're going to do to help them. And we don't need them coming in and saying, this is the way I want you to vote on this particular issue. That's not helping the commissioners by giving them any more information.
Did that happen to you? Because it's not happened to me.
That happened to me, but...
Did you say it happened to someone?
It happened to me.
Well, it sure appears to me that it's happened, you know, here. But I'm just, I would like to see the commissioners let us be more let us make our own independent decision so that we can help. Because if they're coming in and saying, this particular zoning needs to go this way and you need to vote this way, and that's not illegal for them to ask us to do that, but it doesn't help them. And I don't know why they would come and do that, but
I've not had it happen to me, and I've not seen it happen to anyone else. So I feel like I can't even speak to that. I understand what
saying,
it is you're saying.
I'm not pointing out anybody in particular. I'm just saying, in general, I think the commissioners ought to be aware of that, and we ought to be aware that we need to try to help them, not just be a puppet for them.
Right. I think we all kind of agree with that.
I agree with that.
Okay. Well, is that the end of the discussion about efficient public hearing procedures?
That's it. For me.
I just wanted to say one thing. I was a little upset, Jay, being talked to the way you talked to us in the last public hearing. Why that wasn't brought up in the work session.
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about calling us ignorant, making unjust accusations as to things that we were doing. I mean, we sat in this
I
work
was just
session.
Playing off on the words of one of the attorneys when they said their client was ignorant of something.
I mean, we sat in the work session last month and talked about, you know, it's good to talk and be on the same page, and then you brought something up that you never brought up in the work session.
I don't have to.
No, you don't have to, but you sat in the work session and said that's the way we were headed.
Well, let me
you
say,
that
I'm going to answer your question.
Okay.
As to not knowing, I sat here in a work session when you told us what you were going to make for,
right.
Make a motion. That is against our rules.
So why didn't you say that then? Instead,
I did.
No, you didn't. You said, I'm glad to know what you're going to do. We can all get on the same page then.
I can pull that up too.
Yeah.
We got a video, and you know, I said we're not supposed to say how we're going to vote at meetings.
That's not what you said.
Do you agree that you're not supposed to say that? Not supposed to telegraph what your vote is going to be.
I don't think it really matters.
Can you weigh in on that? Does it matter if we publicize what? How are we going to vote before we vote?
We want to approach it with an open mind and acknowledge that the hearing is still ahead of us and that we are going. We might have concerns. We might have significant concerns. And we might talk in detail about the concerns, but I do agree we should acknowledge our vote. I'm not following the details of everything that happened last month. I'm trying to keep up with the discussion here myself.
We've been told that many times by Ken not to.
Generally, yeah. I'm frowned upon sitting in this room and saying that I'm going to deny or I'm going to approve.
Well, I think I'm inclined to. Was the words that I remember Commissioner Nolen using. I'm leaning towards or something like that. I don't think he voiced an opinion absolutely as to how he was going to vote, because I think those were the words you used.
No, he just said what his motion was going to be.
No, I didn't say what my motion was going to be because I didn't even make a motion.
Okay.
But do you realize by bringing that preliminary sketch plat up, the information on that, that you've set up a selective enforcement possibility? Do you know that that's been done before and you've never said a word about it?
It had never really been brought to my attention. Okay. And I do think that, let me see. I think that the sketch plats ought to have a signature, or at least we need to know who it is that's putting them before us. Here's a sketch plat right here.
I'm just saying.
It's a night, and it's got a seal and a stamp on it.
If you go back and look at it.
A lot of the seals have those. Yeah, there are a lot of them that don't. And,
right.
And the, it may be that may be a can of worms, that we've done some things wrong. At some point in time, sometimes you see something that you've been doing wrong.
Well, let me offer up a suggestion.
So are you saying that you ought to just ignore it because you've been doing it wrong all along?
No, I'm just saying you open an opportunity for somebody to have selective enforcement, fraud against you, because you didn't do it in the past.
No, I'm not trying to do selective enforcement. It'd be fine with me to go back and redo every one of them. No. Now, that's not selective.
No, it's not.
And that would be fine. If we've been doing it wrong, then we need to correct it and start doing it right. Saying that I didn't bring it up at a work session, I really was not completely aware of it until between the work session and the public meeting.
Well, let me offer a suggestion.
But I brought it up as soon as I found out. Why didn't you bring it up?
I didn't know anything about it.
Why didn't you?
Because we do it, and it's not...
We've done it wrong all along.
No, okay. Who says it's wrong?
Okay. Yeah, but what I'm trying to say is, rather than getting on to me, I'll say, thanks for bringing it up.
Let me offer a suggestion. In the event that something like that occurs again between the work session and the public hearing, and you find something like that, whoever may find something like that, because we all look through the books and read the books and do site visits and all of this stuff. In the event that happens again, call each and every one of us and say, I have found such and such. Can we just look into this? I have a problem with that.
I don't know.
I think that I have a problem with this. I think it, we need to look into this further. And then each of us can make our own decision, but at least you've brought it to our attention there, rather than holding the book up like this and say, have you all read this? Do you all know this? Because that was as if we were on the witness stand and you were a prosecuting attorney. That's what it made us feel like.
I was showing that to the audience.
I know, but I'm just saying that.
The audience doesn't have access to this book.
Pam held that book up. I didn't hold this book up. I held up the UDC.
Well, you know what I meant, though. You know what I meant.
I mean, to me, it seems like this would be an easy thing to just notify staff. If there's a question about anything that's in the application, ask staff, does this appear complete? That's staff's responsibility to verify that it's complete. And if there's an oversight, then bring it to their attention.
I mean, is there a problem with some of the sketch plans in the past? I mean, I know that they're conceptual in nature, but... The law is not conceptual.
Well, I don't think we agreed last month on how there being problems with that. That was the one where you mentioned it wasn't stamped by an engineer. Is that the issue we're talking about?
That and also it turned out that I didn't bring this up. I mean, and I don't necessarily want to replay it, but since you brought it up, and if you're asking the questions, I'll answer the question. But if you don't want me to talk about it, tell me you don't want me to talk about it. But I will. I will say that there's some problems, especially when the engineering firm is saying they're like incorporated or something, and there's no corporation that exists, and there's no way to find out who it is. You know. Of course, on the other hand, you can say we don't need to know who it is, but don't you like to?
What we brought up last month at the meeting, and was that section of the code says, and I don't have it open right in a second, but it says, et cetera. It lists a few different people that could prepare a plan, and then it says, et cetera. So,
and et cetera doesn't... I mean, I've had talks with Ken and stuff too, and I forget what I was talking about, but
I'm comfortable that plan was prepared by someone that plan was prepared by whoever, and I'm comfortable with it going forward with planning commission.
Well, how about
that particular example?
Do you want, you know, because you're right, I want to be fair to everybody. Mm-hmm. I don't want to select out one particular thing.
Well,
it would suit me fine to go back and check every one of these. Are you suggesting maybe we do that?
I have done that.
Okay. So what do we come up with?
That's probably about a quarter of them were done the way that one was done. And there's probably three other firms that turned in plans that were not listed on the Secretary of State's website.
Uh-huh.
So,
were they corporation? My main thing is somebody signing off on it.
Yeah, there was no stamp, no signature on several of them.
Yeah, I understand that it's not just one. And I have no problem with going back and looking into some of those if we ought to, but I mean, that's pretty serious business to do all that. And I realized what I was talking about was pretty serious because I thought it was pretty serious, you know. But if it's not, then we'll ignore it and move on.
I have a suggestion. This isn't really germane to that topic. Can we put this into next month's agenda if this specific thing needs to be?
As I said, I mean, I'm just answering the question.
We just have a lot of people here. I don't want to hold.
It will be included. It will be included next month.
I didn't bring it up.
What we're going to talk about under number 8 on tonight's agenda that I added, this will be discussed next month.
Who prepares plans or questioning of other members? What?
Both of those things.
I mean, yeah, who prepares plans could be a discussion of.
Mm-hmm. Got it down?
Down.
We'll move on to number 5 then. Listing of application status.
I wanted to discuss a product that Teresa at one time would give the Planning Commission, and it basically shows where applications are in the overall process, not just what you're seeing in a given month coming to a public hearing. This is just an example. It's not showing applications that are before you this month, but you get an idea that it tracks, first of all, in a given month, those applications that are going before the Board of Commissioners, those that are going before the Planning Commission, as well as those in applicant work time. Those in applicant work time have gone through zoning review. Staff is waiting on revisions and other requested changes, as well as the public participation report. These are ones that have not been scheduled for a public hearing yet. And finally, those applications that will be coming up for the following month's zoning review. So the question is whether the Planning Commission would like this product to be reinstituted. The idea would be that this type of product would be given to you at the work session for the given month, again with the next month's applications. And if this is something you would like to have, what I would do is I would print it off and put it in your file folders for the work session. Now, understand that this would have, it would be prepared and there would be a stop date, which means applicant work time. If someone turns in the rest of their board, you know, different materials, you know, the day or 2 or 3 days before the work session, it's not necessarily going to be indicated there. And what I can do is just put a date that that it was prepared, so you understand that this document would be up to date per the date on the document.
This has always been very helpful for me when we did it before. I'm one of the ones who really did use it. I don't know if everybody uses it or not, but I did look at it and pay attention to it, because oftentimes I'll look at this and go on e-status and see where things are and what they are, so that if I'm out and about, I'll know.
And we heard that from you, heard from Jenny too. So before Teresa left, I said, Teresa, bring this back. After earlier in the year, had fouling our February meeting. There was so much follow-up in the meeting and all the discussion about minutes and everything else. This is a product the Planning Commission had never really recognized officially as something they were getting. And I said, Teresa, just, it doesn't seem like anyone's looking at it anyways. Just drop it for now. And I was wrong. It turned out people were looking at it. People were looking at it a good bit. So I said, well, let's, Teresa, give us an updated version before you retire. We got that. We wanted to just formally tonight hear from the Planning Commission as a whole. We heard from two members. We want to hear from three or more that, yeah, this is something we want. We'll bring it back. And but we're not going to put it, if it's all right with you, we weren't going to put it as an agenda item. We used to have it as an agenda item. I thought it was always somewhat of an unproductive part of the meeting. You sit here and kind of read it to you.
I felt the same way.
Just going to make it. Yeah, and that's kind of what I based my decision on, why when I said, Teresa, stop making it, because that part of the meeting was always so unproductive. Mm-hmm. Well, we do need to get any information. We don't need to talk or read it to you, well, is the answer.
Right.
I've got one question. How much time is involved? I personally, if I want to know, just like Chairman said, mm-hmm. go to East Adams. This is all on East Adams, isn't it?
I think it's not all. Isn't that the case?
It is on
not this, but I'm talking about the zoning and the dates and all
the applications. Everything on this list would be on e-status because yeah. they submitted an application and it's somewhere then uh-huh. in this process. Now it's not going to be lined up or classified. They're mm-hmm. not going to be grouped together like this. Mm-hmm. In terms of the amount of staff time, this is a custom document, which means we don't run a report. We hand type everything in. There's not a way to
so it's
us
time
to grab. It takes a certain amount of time to produce it.
How long?
I don't know.
I bet you don't know because you've not done it yet, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can look at the agenda and then you can go to the e-status and find it, you know, and
saving
money.
Yet, but you could go to e-status and find it.
Yeah.
The only thing on your agenda is what would be in
yeah, right here. Yes. But this is going, this other stuff will be there. You just have to look for it.
That is correct.
And I kind of remember this board going when that when we were talking bylaws and stuff and trying to bring everything together in one thing. And I heard a lot of people say, we don't need to bring it all together. So the UGC, you can go find it if you've got a question. Remember when we had those discussions? This is in the East Adams. Why do we have to bring it together here? We can go find it on East Adams.
For me, this is easy. If somebody has a quick question, they call me and I can glance at it and answer their question quickly without having to go searching for it, because sometimes you get questions and then to have to go back and look it up and call them back. You know, it's a process for them as it is, just as it is for me. So that's where I find it helpful personally.
But at the same time, it depends on how much it costs. We can't afford to pay for education. But we're going to pay for this. And that's why I was trying to get specific on, are we spending enough money on this during the course of a year to be able to pay for some education?
I say, I'm on e-status a good bit. So most of the time, I mean, it wasn't as important to me because I usually just look through everything. But I was curious about, I mean, to me, it seems like this would be handy for the public just because, you know, somebody's able to look and see what's coming up or where the status is, like what all zoning cases are potentially coming up in the next month or something like that. Could this not be formatted in an I know that the website is kind of a PHP type of website. I mean, they can create tables in any format. Could it just be created as a table?
Okay, you know, one of the first things I'd have to look at is this historically has been kind of this default handy reference type of thing. Mm-hmm. And if we're changing it and putting it out there as more of a product for public consumption, I'd have to do a little bit of homework on the quality side of it. And I'd be nervous then we'd be hearing, you know, the first time something doesn't, right now if you miss something, not the end of the world.
Until the disclaimer.
You get a phone call that you can't answer, and you call me, and I tell you the answer.
Yeah.
As soon as we put out there for public consumption, it makes it a little more complicated.
And absolutely, and that would put even a further layer of commitment to get another product out when we, of course, input everything for e-status. Everything is done by the zoning administrator for e-status. And our primary commitment is to the e-status system. I would say it would be a big difference to have this in a work session file for you to review versus on the website as yet another format of e-status information.
I appreciate what you all had to say, but I'm coming at it from a different point of view because I feel like the information's out there on e-status. And this would be a good way to save some money. And as I said, my first, I'd transfer that money to education in a heartbeat. You know,
well, we could say that about a lot of things.
Hmm?
We could say that about a lot of things.
We could say that about our books.
We could say that about the time that we spend with Kent. We could say that about, you know, the printouts that we get for lots of different things.
Okay. I'm approaching this from a different point of view. I respect the fact that y'all would like to see this, but.
So do you need a motion? Do you need a vote or?
I'd like
a
motion
consensus
to, just,
or?
Since we've heard different, we've got some opposing views, I'd appreciate a motion. Just make it clean, make it clear what we need to do in the future.
So I'll make a motion that we reinstate the use of this document.
Second.
I don't know what it's called.
All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
No.
Motion passes 4-1 with Commissioner Moses being opposed. I didn't say it, I'm sorry.
Thanks for listening to me.
Certainly. Now, review and discussion of applications scheduled for public hearing on July 23rd, 2013. First one is CP130002, Midway Community Church. District 3. Anybody have any comments, concerns, heard anything from anybody?
No. That was Pastor Rock when I looked at the site. Addition.
Is this addition in the where the ball field is, or is it next to it?
Next to it.
Okay.
There is an existing building there too. If you go on the look at the PDFs, you can see the existing. It just didn't. I guess it faded out in the print. So, when I first looked at the plan,
right,
I was trying to figure
it
out.
It's actually a bad gauge. It's a bad gauge.
So we're on
this
side.
Yeah. It's 50 feet off
of that. They have a lot of space out there, I noticed.
Where are you showing it? Houston, Bill?
Well, it's hard to say. It's just a print. I guess, you know, whenever you print these half size, the
right
wings,
oh, okay,
were shaded, so
you're talking about
up
church.
Yeah,
okay.
You can't see where it is relative to existing,
okay,
but there's there.
No variance request. Staff is supportive. Any other discussion? CP130004, Jennifer A. Blackburn, Verizon Wireless. I have not heard anything either for or against this monopole.
Very industrial.
Very industrial, that's correct. Although I did have a question because on the very first page it says applicant is requesting a variance, but I don't think that they are, because back over here on the last page it says none. So I think it was just a typo, yeah. Because I don't think they need a variance back there.
We'll double check that by next week, but looking quickly, I'm in agreement.
Yeah, in reading everything.
In the application, it says none.
Yes. Yeah.
It's, Vanessa, if you make a note, well, as you're reading this off on the agenda next week, let's clarify that. Just add an extra sentence to what you're reading.
And the third party reviewer is supportive. Cityscape is supportive. Staff is supportive. And it's really 150-foot pole with 10 inches or 10, whatever it is, the last foot for the lightning rod.
It's not going to look like a giant redwood.
No. I'm not a fan of the ones that they try to make look like trees. I think that they stand out more when they try to make them look like trees. This is, in reading all of this material, this is... It's really for the way things are changing. And Cityscape recommends that they have four other carriers. So it's for more than just cell phones, it's for data and I don't know what you call all that because I don't know the language of all of that, but so it's for future things. And like I say, I've not heard anything from anyone. I was not able to go to the public participation meeting because it was the same night as our public hearing, I believe. Either our public hearing or our last work session. That was the reason. C is E. Howard Parsons, ZA3630. That would be Commissioner Moses' district. Any comments, concerns?
I heard from one person, but it's my understanding that Mr. Parson and he have come to an agreement on what needs to be done there. So, as far as I'm concerned, everything is in order. Okay. Staff is supporting for this.
And this has a variance. In between structures. When is that coming up? When are those changes coming up? Thursday night?
Yes.
Bet y'all are glad. Maybe we'll get some closure on it. Is that it for that one? Next is ZA3631 Shallow Barnett LLC. District 3, Commissioner Nolen.
There have been concerns about the density zoning. Not being conformity with what's there already.
Do we know the lot size?
$6,000.
this was the one where they wanted a variance for the open space, right?
Yes.
Oh, it says on this one.
Non-supportive.
On the last one, it says 7,000 square foot minimum lot size.
They're, yeah, early in their application, the second page, they put 6,000 square feet.
But on the site, on the last page, right before the yellow page, it says minimum lot size 7,000.
From a comprehensive plan perspective, that would not make the difference.
And there is no builder or developer yet. That's to be determined.
So the staff's not supportive because it doesn't go along with the comprehensive plan?
That's correct.
How liable is the county? I mean, this is a legal question, but how liable is the county? Because I've never really gotten that completely clear about this. If we oppose, if the Board of Commissioners votes to not approve a zoning, and they've turned it down based on the fact that it's not in agreement with the long-term plan, how likely is the county, well, I know they could get sued, but how likely, is that a viable reason to sue the county, even though we follow your recommendation and vote against it? It's just a...
Well, the way I think I could best answer it is to say, if you are going to deny something and it's inconsistent with the comprehensive plan, that's one of the best, that's one of the first things you're going to want to verify, like that you made a decision. The county adopted a plan. It's a guideline and tool you use to evaluate rezonings.
So that's a legitimate reason for it.
Well, it's a legitimate reason, and it's probably the most, it's probably the best reason you have most of the time. Now, the thing you have to take into consideration, and one of the reasons why we have this five-person board, is the plan isn't perfect. And you might find a situation where you look at it and you say, well, this tiny little piece of property is surrounded by industrial, and the plan just missed it. The plan showing it to be low-density residential. If it's something like that and you look at it and you think the plan just is less than ideal, you think the plan overlooked it, then I don't think you want to deny it and hang your hat on the comprehensive plan. It's a good product, mm-hmm. and the county dedicated a lot of resources to creating it, but it's not perfect.
But when y'all deny it,
7,000 something parcels in the county, and there could be a couple out there where it just missed the mark.
But generally, if you say, if the staff says you're not supportive, you feel pretty good about hanging your hat on that.
We do.
Okay.
Any other discussion on that one?
Thank you.
Next is ZA3633, Lennar, Georgia, Inc., District 3.
Same concerns. We're getting that it's not conforming.
Have you heard from a lot of people on this one?
Only one.
Huh?
Just one.
One.
Mm-hmm.
I have some concerns about the lots that are here in the creek is and the pond.
Yeah, they're trying to get variances on
that. Yeah, they're trying to go into that buffer, and I just, that to me seems like.
Well, what they gotta do is try to reduce the front yard.
Well, they are, but the lot's still within the buffer, and so whether the house sits in the buffer or not, so it's still gonna be used. So it's just a concern. Something that I see when I look at the plan.
Yeah, there's three lines there, that farthest or the outermost line, that one is an impervious area setback. So
Right. Any
impervious area that got put in that typically should be something that gets permitted, I would think, like an accessory structure. Mm-hmm. If somebody
wouldn't put impervious in that area.
Right, you so would not put impervious not, yes. in that area. So what I was saying, there's hardly anything where somebody could go down there and put any impervious in that area that they shouldn't be getting a permit for, is there? Like accessory structures generally would require.
Unpermitted work, yeah.
Yeah.
We're not gonna permit anything impervious in there.
Right.
And could things just end up in there? Could, yeah.
I'm sure.
It happens. If we're made aware of it, court enforcement will go out and have them relocate it. Mm-hmm. It does happen.
And then there's lots too. I guess they're also subject to an IDP permit, usually, which is an individual lot permit. That's a little more there's more scrutiny on those, I guess, than on lots that don't have it. They do have to provide a more detailed building plan and have it reviewed as a full engineering plan.
So it's very likely, yeah. Years ago, we had any lot within 200 feet of state waters required that. And over time, the engineering department has gotten more and more sophisticated, and now they require that case by case when they see environmentally sensitive issues. And I think there's a decent chance, a very good chance, those lots would fall in that category and have a more detailed plan.
No, Sam, I support it. Just mentioned that because concerns about it.
So there's four lots that they're concerned about with that one over in that area. And then the third variance is exterior yard setback.
Just the where the property line is.
96 and then
the shape of the
lot. Well, that's the shape, yeah.
So Steph was on the
floor.
Is it non-supportive because of the because of it being risk four?
Yes.
Okay. I was just curious because I know the density of this one is really, it's pretty low.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just trying to figure out if
it's lot size surrounding use. You know, for instance, we have one res four suburban one LLC ZA3623, whether we're supportive to or not. So we're looking at surrounding
So when you look at that, when you go into an area where a lot of it is A1 around it, and they come in and they are buying a tract of land that's amongst these A1s and they want res 4, staff will not be supportive because surrounding them is A1, basically?
That's part of it, but so much of the character issue with, you know, is res 4 appropriate for suburban living is
right.
That lot size difference. And that is just as important as the density issue when you're talking about community character.
Res 3 and res 4,
yes.
The difference in the
yes. So sometimes res 4 can have that lower density because of their overall acreage, but
right.
You're still looking at a much smaller lot size than
three. Okay. I was curious about that because I know we talked about that, and I think a lot of that people on the Planning Commission agreed that sometimes having more flexibility in the lots would be considered a good thing, but then that would also change the character.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Simply by just the adding flexibility to the lot. So that's why I was trying to figure out if it, you know, in this case, it's lower density than a good bit of res 3 product, but the difference is the lot size.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm guessing that it's because of the topography with that big lake. A lot of it.
Yeah, I mean, it provides a good bit of a there's an open area there.
Yeah. Did this person that you heard from, Craig, did they go to the public participation meeting and voice their concerns there?
I'm pretty sure they did. Their property backs up to these three lots that kind of stick out on the left side.
Mm-hmm.
This is the one that didn't have the comments.
Yeah, I didn't see the comments of the public participation in this one.
They had their own meeting.
I will,
it's probably online.
For those, and I apologize, this is our new process. Now, an applicant can submit their public participation report, including a comment, after the books are made. And they can just submit it later. So I will pass out what the applicant submitted.
To you.
I can email it. It's so I can email that tomorrow.
Is it online, Vanessa? Because we could access it that way if it's in the report online.
It is not online yet.
Okay.
So I will make sure I will. Thank you.
So that's a change.
With the rezoning changes, one of the flexible options that was added is before the process was the full public participation report had to come in at the board's submittal deadline. So everything came in at once. We then make sure it's complete. We run the legal ad. It's put in your books. Everything is complete. In order to give an applicant more time to compile the report, which was something that was requested during our user-friendly initiative, we extended the time period of when an applicant can submit that report, which would be after the legal ad, and we run the books generally, you know, at a certain time period. And so,
so this is the first time we've had this. This
yes,
is something
this is
new.
The first time. This is the first time we've gotten in a report. I don't want to say late, but later than we normally receive.
Is that a good thing? To not be aware of.
I think you voted for it, so I hope so.
Yeah, but I mean, I didn't. I mean, is it a good thing? I'm not talking about that, but I guess I am. But a good thing for us to not have the input.
Well,
from
we do get it before this meeting, right, Vanessa?
It's available.
Is it the day of the meeting that it's due, or is it before the meeting?
And this was just something that I didn't.
I'm thinking about in the future.
Well, in the future, I will have it for this meeting.
Oh, okay. Well, that would be fine.
Okay.
Yeah, because I don't want
won't
to.
Be in your
that's
book.
Where I'm headed.
It could be abused.
Be
you know, it could be abused. But
you should have it by this meeting.
Well, okay, yeah, or in that case, there's no problem.
So we can get it to you for this meeting.
And it will be that's loose, good. Which means you're
that's
just going to have to submit it in your book.
Yeah.
I don't know how often this will happen. It's up to the applicant.
I know.
So, it's fine. We'll see.
Yeah. There's room for abuse there, and I don't, you know, I think that we ought to be privy to what the comments are.
Well, from the flip side, I'll say it's a risk for a developer not to give that information early on, because if they have their public meeting late,
mm-hmm.
and you know, they put a lot of investment into trying to get these applications, if they can't address those early. And I think I mentioned that, you know, right now with the time frame, if somebody comes in at the very last minute, they might find out 2 days before our meeting that, you know, there's a huge amount of opposition and they have no time mm-hmm. to resolve it. So it puts a huge risk on them if they aren't doing it in advance.
Alan's absolutely right, and that's something that we discuss, you know, as the application is going through processing. So it's balancing, you know, maybe needing additional time to pull the report together,
yeah.
and also it could result in a postponement since it's been advertised. That is a risk.
Yeah. But I think it's fair the way we're doing it, that if we can, as long as we can get it, because I think that applicant ought to have all the time that they can legally have right up to, but at the same time, we need to have the comments or have the stuff if we're gonna make the right decision. So if we can, if you can do that, then we don't have a problem. It's just a glitch on fights, right.
Well, in the public participation meeting, oftentimes you get a gist of what's gonna happen at the public hearing. You know what's gonna be, what the opposition is gonna say. Mm-hmm. So you won't be surprised too much by it, kinda know. Any other discussion on that one? Moving on to ZA3604, Bridge Stables. Commissioner, yeah.
No, I think I just forwarded on the information. I know that there was an attorney, one of the attorneys mentioned last time that they had sent information to the commissioner. None of them had seen it, I think, except from Hayes. So I just forwarded those proposed conditions over. And did get an information packet in the mail that kind of went through. Is a letter from Tim Bush, and it also had those conditions, yeah, attached to it. Aside from that, I have not really heard very much this month on it.
Anybody have any other discussion on this? We already had the public hearing, so this will be a recommendation decision only next week. Moving on is discussion of August training session. Tom, do you want to take this or do you want me to?
Why don't you start off and I'll add anything I think. Okay.
Ken Gerard is going to be doing some training about what the Planning Commission duties are, what we can and cannot do. He's going to discuss conditions. He's going to discuss what we're supposed to consider to make our recommendation decisions and other things that we need to be aware of. And what the request that I got is that between now and a week before the work session in August, if you all have something specific that you would like him to go over, you need to make Tom aware of that, and Tom will then prepare that and give it to Ken.
You could send it to him directly as well.
Okay.
Well, I always try to make that, in case your complaint's about me.
Oh, okay. We'll make note of that. If you're gonna complain about Tom, just send it directly to Ken. Or Vanessa, that too.
I would just change slightly. I would like to say, I would really like to hear the Planning Commission say that they would like for Ken to come in. We talked about, could he come in and some of the different things he could cover if he were to come in. But part of what I want to hear from the Planning Commission is, yeah, we think, you know, this list of things we talked about are worthwhile getting some advice on, and we would like him to come in.
Yeah, because we added several things. I think you made a list tonight of things that we discussed.
Talked about minute adoption, training, who prepares plans, who prepares site plans, questioning other members, questioning the public in general. You would just mention conditions, considerations for approval or action. So we got a running list of things. Some of them are a little more on the planning side, and I might have more to say on them than others. And others are maybe more on the legal side, where he would take the lead.
This is a little bit. I think this would be if we do it. It would be a little bit different training session than what he has done with us before. Apparently, he used to do this.
We talked about it. And that last class we had was more about, here are the things you can't do. Here are the things that are going to get us in trouble, or here are the things we absolutely have to do. this one, from what I took away from the discussion, was more about what's the vision of the Planning Commission? What does the Planning Commission want to accomplish? What's the ideal? Where are we going in 5 years? How do we help the commissioners? How do we help the commissioners implement the comprehensive plan? Some of the more abstract things. Our last training session was the very specific do's and don'ts. What I'm hearing on this one is more, okay, we got the do's and don'ts out of the way, and that had to be priority number one. Now we're on to priority number two, and priority number two is the more lofty, ambitious things. So if you want that, I'd just like to hear it. You can come to those meetings for free, and I'm glad to bring them, but I want to make sure everyone's in agreement.
I would like to commend Commissioner Bowman on being open to a lot of these new ideas that you've got in trying to improve the Planning Commission. I know it's taken us some time to discuss some of it and stuff and bring it in, but I think it's really good that you're broadening us and trying to get us to be educated and on the stuff and learn the rules and laws and we can discuss maybe bylaws. I want to commend you for doing that, because it hasn't always been that way, and I think that's a major milestone that you're leading us in the proper direction. So
thank you.
Kudos
for that.
On that. And should we make a motion on that, Tom?
I like it.
I'd like to make a motion that we have Ken Gerard speak to us sometime in August for additional training.
At the August work session.
Yeah.
I'll second that. All those in favor of Commissioner Moses' motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0. May I have a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Commissioner Neal?
I'll second.
Commissioner Iglesias seconded it. All those in favor of, is there any discussion on adjournment? All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion to adjourn passes 5-0 at 8:06 p.m. Got done sooner than I thought. I said 8:30.
I got lots of work. I'm so covered up. It's good and it's bad at the same time. But I'm pleased to have the work.
There's a lot going on.
I did the same just, thing.
The last one.
He said there was
just so that I done.
I am.
Like my safety net. Yeah. It is for me. Unless I get thrown a curveball. But I've gotten better at being able to do that. I know that I'm better at it.
That's what he's talking about. This next one down.
She knew it.
And I'm glad to
Always myself.
When I met with them,